Coming to Northeast Wisconsin live from the Civic Media Studios and featuring TV and radio broadcast veteran John Mino, along with the City of Green Bay's longest serving mayor, Jim Schmidt. This is Mino and the Mayor. Begin the day with a friendly voice, a companion unobtrusive. And here are your hosts, John Mino and Jim Schmidt.
Thank you very much. Welcome back. Mino and the Mayor here. On a Wednesday, 9/11, of course, here at 97.9 FM WGBW, 98.3 FM WISS in the Civic Media app. We talk all the time, Jim, especially with the draft coming up, how we need to find a place that we're going to turn into an Airbnb, because it seems like you're just pretty much printing money from there on out, right?
Well, and it's grown a lot here in Green Bay, right? You look at all the Airbnbs because of the Packer expansion, but there's so many events going on, and people are very comfortable
and
with Airbnbs.
And we think we basically unlock the door and life is good.
Right. Just open the door and let them come in and leave the check on the table.
Izzy Deutsch, my friend. How you doing, buddy?
Johnny, good. How are you?
Good. Are you still doing Ironmans? I'm not.
No, I haven't done it for a while. I got too busy in life.
Okay, good. So, Izzy, you and I were great friends when you were a police officer here in the Green Bay area in Brown County. And you did a lot. First of all, I just want to ask you to go back on the 9/11 thing. For somebody like yourself, what you've done in your career-wise, what does this day mean to you, Izzy?
It's really a day to remember our heroes and what they sacrificed and their families that, you know, today are still affected and their coworkers and stuff like that. So that's really what the bottom line is, just remembering what they've done for us in this country, because them going into a building that is on fire trying to rescue people, that's selfless. So just trying to remember them and their families again and coworkers.
Awesome.
Yeah, and I'm so glad there's so much video there. You know, because sometimes you talk about stuff, you know, Pearl Harbor, whatever, and there's maybe a picture or something, but here that was so well covered.
Yeah.
And I just think that if kids don't know about it, or if we forget about it, you know, there's a lot of documentaries on that, but sit down and watch that again.
I agree. Well, Izzy, we're switching gears here and talking about something that is just, because we talk a lot here about Airbnbs and the draft, and we've got a wonderful gentleman, Michael, who helps run an agency to help people facilitate to make sure things don't go wrong. Could you just explain in the wonderful, wonderful little town of Sheboygan Falls, which I really like, with the river going through it and the whole thing. I love that little town. Tell me your background, what you did, what you had, and what happened.
Sure. So we own a business called Crafty American. Every business has a business out. So our business out is investing in real estate. So there was an opportunity for a building in downtown Sheboygan Falls, which is a historic downtown area.
Yep.
And we're going to make that into our shop, and soon realized after buying it that it was too small, so we didn't know what to do with it. So we started renting the downstairs to a business, and we didn't know what to do with the upstairs. There wasn't even a stove upstairs in the unit, but we converted that into an Airbnb and made it a farmhouse style with some of our Crafty American art in there, firefighter art.
Cool.
So nice. It was doing extremely successful, extremely well, especially shockingly enough downtown. We get people from Road America, golfers, wedding people for the Kohler area. Sometimes you get some Packer people that don't want to go all the way home. It's like a halfway point between Milwaukee or Chicago. We get people from all over the world that stay there for Kohler events. So it goes pretty well. Now, recently in August, and I'll explain maybe some things that were helpful for people out there if they're going to rent through Airbnb or VRBO or bookings.com. But recently we had someone leave the water running in the kitchen, and 640 gallons of water went through the kitchen faucet and then went to the downstairs. So now the entire place is gutted out, and we're waiting for the renovation to be completed to get our place back up and running. So what happened recently. So we're shut down probably through the end of October.
Did they forget, or was it intentional?
Well, at first it doesn't look intentional, but explaining some things to protect yourself in Airbnbs, we have the exterior all camered. After reviewing the camera footage, they're lying about what to do and cover up for what they did. But it appears that the kitchen sink got plugged somehow, and somebody must have left the water running. Either they're heavily intoxicated on camera and passed out and forgot they had the water running, or some other event may have occurred. We're not sure on that.
So people who are thinking of renting, I went with the agency. I went with Michael.
Simple Life Hospitality.
And they're doing the background check. Do you do that, or how does that work? I mean, how did these people get into your place?
Sure. So there's many different ways of doing background checks. Again, you can pay someone to do a background check for you. It's kind of a waste of money, in my opinion, if you're going to background check everyone. But during this time for the NFL draft, I would highly recommend that, especially if you're not long-terming your Airbnb or your house or your rental for Airbnb. If it's just a one-week thing, I would highly recommend hiring someone to do that. There's lots of different places out there online that will do background checks for you. You can do basic checks like Wisconsin Circuit Court Access if they're in Wisconsin. Mind you, a lot of people come from out of state. Right. So there's different state laws and what they can give out to the general public. There's even things like just looking at the reviews on Airbnb or VRBO. Sure. And see what the reviews are. However, if the host and guest don't review themselves, sometimes those reviews aren't publicized in those areas. So for instance, if I review a guest but the guest doesn't review me, it may not be posted on their page, and they could be a horrible guest and show 5 stars, but behind the scenes there might be a couple 1 stars, but because we didn't review each other, it may not have been posted. So that's not really 100% reliable on that.
How about the sounds like there's some pretty serious damage because it went down to the first floor. Did you take out special insurance, or is that covered? Tell me yep. about what, like, I'm worried about that with my house. I gotta be honest with you, but that's why I went with this service, because sure. they're taking care of it. But I mean, that would be awful to come back to.
Oh, nightmare.
Yeah, and water damage is nothing worse. Maybe
nothing
fire,
worse.
But, yeah.
For our case, we're into the 6 figures. When we first purchased the building, we took out an extra rider for insurance. I would highly recommend anyone renting out for the NFL draft to contact their homeowner's insurance and see what it would cover. Because if they're going to run it as a business, a lot of residential insurance companies will not cover that at all. So I would highly recommend at least calling the insurance company and saying, hey, this is what we're going to do. Is this going to be covered or not? The next thing you can do is you can require deposits on Airbnb or VRBO or bookings.com. You can even have them through VRBO make a insurance purchase as part of the rental. So there's different stages or different
right.
price values of taking out the additional insurance. Just keep in mind, though, Airbnb and VRBO aren't in the best interest of hosts. They make more money on guests. So it's extremely difficult trying to recover some of the money from these platforms, because they're about making money and profit. They're not your best friend. So you have to keep that in mind. What's the best interest for yourself? Because a lot of times when you're calling and trying to get help, you're going to get someone that doesn't understand what's going on. They are just going by protocol for their company. And a lot of times these places that claim large dollar amounts, let's say a host like myself trying to claim a large dollar amount in 6 figures, they'll just shut them down after they pay out a claim or something. And they're allowed to do that. It's their business. And they're just shutting people down because after they make the big payout, they don't want too much of a liability. They don't want to be a host anymore. Oh. So
are those kind of mom and pop places? That. You know what I mean?
Some are large places. If you go into a lot of Facebook groups nationally about Airbnb and VRBO host renting, you'll learn a lot on those pages. And there's a lot of horror stories about somebody having 20 rentals and just overnight they got shut down because they argued with Airbnb about a guest damaging their property. They got paid out, and all of a sudden, next day, Airbnb shut their entire platform down, and they're owning 20 rentals, and they're scrambling on what to do because now they can't rent out 20 different real estate properties.
Wow. Izzy, what's the legal ramifications that you can do with those people?
For us in Wisconsin, you got to show some type of criminal intent. There's elements of crimes that occur when people are trying to cover up certain things and make excuses on camera, saying, "Hey, let's just tell them this, let's tell them that." It could be intent, or if they know that there's actually extreme damage in this case, they know the whole building had extreme damage but failed to call anyone or failed to do anything to prevent any further damage, knowing it's going to get worse and worse and worse. It may be criminal matter on that because they intended or knew that it was going to create more damage but didn't allow any type of fix to occur or contact me. So there's some criminal ramifications possibly in that, or local ordinances.
Are you going after them?
I've made a police report. Now it's up to the police department to show those elements of the crime or the intent for criminal damage. So unfortunately, I just retired from law enforcement about 4 or 5 months ago. So I kind of just have to let them do their investigation and look into the matter before they decide what they're going to do with it.
Wow.
So I don't want to discourage people. I mean, this is a sad story. I'm sorry this happened to you. But you know, that was a terrible incident that happened. But overall, has it been a good experience for you guys? You and your partner, you said you guys bought that building. Would you encourage someone to do it as a little side hustle?
Yeah, I don't. You got to come up with a business plan, being one, and make sure you're protected. That's key. Before you get into whether it's worth it or not, you have to do certain things with your property to make sure that you're not liable for certain things. One, again, we talked about insurance. Two, you got to make sure that you cover yourself as far as make sure your smoke detectors, smoke alarms are working. Make sure there's emergency exits and people know how to get in and out of those emergency exits. Two, you got to make sure you're up to the local ordinances. There's a lot of ordinances that don't allow like one night rentals and stuff. So you have to ask your local municipality if you're allowed to do VRBOs or you're going to get in trouble yourself.
And they're inconsistent. I just want to say we have 24 municipalities in Brown County and, you know, it's just, they did come in. We got our license. They came and inspected, but you're right. It's not just smoke. It's carbon monoxide. You need both of those in the city of Green Bay. Right. I don't know what it is.
Absolutely. Yeah. Yep. And a lot of times you have to get a permit to the health department because it's considered a rental of some sort, like a hotel or motel or bed and breakfast. There's a difference between all of those. Ours is called a lodging house. The law states all of them are different. You probably want some cameras on the outside of your property. Now, you can't have cameras inside your property. And ethically, it wouldn't be a good idea. But on the outside of your property, you're able to monitor if they're having a party or not. We have decibel readers in ours so that we can set it at a certain rating. Now, the only thing we didn't have in ours was a main water shutoff valve that you can control Wi-Fi or through your phone in case there's a certain amount of water. But there's a scenario for everything out there. If I had everything smart home like I do, somebody could leave the window open and all of a sudden ring it in and ruin the floor. So
Izzy, could you stick around for a 1 minute break? This is really fascinating stuff. And I think it's really important for people around here right now.
No.
Really important. So please stay with us. Izzy Deutsch talking about
challenges.
Airbnb and challenges of running your own. Yeah, we'll be back right after this. Reminding me of long ago. Back then I thought that things were never going to change. I know now that things will never be the same. No more. Hey, welcome back. Mino the Mayor here. We're talking with Izzy Deutsch, who owns an Airbnb, and we've had so many people interested in, you know, at least sticking their toes into the water, kind of, well, you know, with the draft coming in. You have a built-in audience.
Right. We had an event here. Just, are you interested in Airbnb? And over 200 people showed up.
Right.
That's a lot. And you make some really, really good points. And I just don't want to scare people away because we need Airbnbs. The hotels are kind of gone. And we're going to have, you know, what, 200,000-300,000 people here. We'd like them to stay in the city because then they'll spend money. You know, if they stay and you know, God bless, you know, Sheboygan Falls, but we'd like them to stay here. And the way we can accommodate them is to have more Airbnbs. And so, but you had a bad experience. I mean, you had a lot of good ones too, but you had a bad experience. And I think
And it sounds like you're really on the ball with decibel things. So if somebody like you can, you know what I mean, have a problem like this.
But we don't want to scare people. And as you really shared with some good things, is that really spend the money on a background check, especially if you're first timers or you're just going to do this temporarily. We're only doing it temporarily, but again, we went with a service. And definitely the house inspection to make sure it's safe because you could get in trouble if it's not.
Yeah, so we were talking about whether it's worth it or not. It can be very, very lucrative. Short-term rentals, I think, are better than long-term rentals. People are in there less. You're making more money per month, et cetera. Again, you just got to protect yourself to make sure that if anything happens, somebody falls, breaks a leg, you're covered, making sure people aren't having parties because it could be a detriment to your neighborhood.
your neighbors are going to be upset if people are having parties.
Right.
But in the long run, you meet a lot of great people that rent out your place from all over the world. People really enjoy it. They don't know where else to stay. I've had race car drivers from Road America stay because they don't want to stay close to there, and they appreciate having a low-key area. So it's extremely lucrative, and I'm happy we've done it. I remember the first time we're like, are we going to do this or not? You know, really nervous, having a second mortgage payment, et cetera. But looking in hindsight and looking behind, I think it was the best decision for our family to make. It's just, again, making sure you check the boxes and you do everything correctly, because you don't want to get dinged for an ordinance ticket on there, because they're going to know if you rent it out or not. If there's an ordinance for the city saying you have to have a permit for it, you better get the permit, because a lot of these companies, again, sell the information of where these Airbnbs are to third-party software companies that give it to municipalities of where people are renting out their houses on this.
And it's $2,500 here. That's $2,500 a day fine. That's what the county's looking at. That's a lot.
Yeah, it's a lot. And if you make $1,500 for, you know, that week, or maybe $1,500 a night, you're losing all that profit. It defeats the purpose of what you're doing.
So do you could I get in trouble for discrimination? Because I put right on there, no Bear fans allowed. No, I didn't. I'm just kidding.
You know, that's another thing you have to keep in mind of, like, service animals. You know, service animals, let's say you don't allow pets in your place, unfortunately, you got to allow service animals. So there's some things you have to look at that ordinary people may not know the laws for. So just make sure you're knowledgeable on that. You know, and again, if you hire a company that will rent out your place for you, fantastic. They do most of their legwork for you on that. You don't have to worry about it, you know.
And that's what Simple Life Hospitality does, too. Let me ask this, Izzy. Tell me a little bit more. You just, it's like, what? When you said about some of these things you can get on your, again, I'm old. I'm not
technically. Smart house.
Tell me about some of those things.
For the smart home thing?
Yeah.
So everything in our place is smart home, where we can control it, not because we want the guests to be, you know, buttoned down and not be able to control things. But to give you an instance, we have a smart thermostat. For some reason, in the summertime, some people like it really hot in there, and they're turning the heat up at 80 degrees on a 90-degree day for whatever reason. It's going to ruin your furnace. So for us, we lock out the heat in the summertime just because it's going to ruin that HVAC unit. We try to explain to people how to control things. If the smoke alarm goes off, I'm going to know about it on my phone, not because I want to sit here and monitor them, but if there really is a fire, I want to make sure that they're safe and they feel safe. We have alarms inside the building, so if they want to set the alarm because it's a place that they're unfamiliar with, maybe they don't know the neighborhood, they can actually set the security alarm so they feel safe. If the door opens up in the middle of the night, they would know about it. It is that added feature for people to feel safe inside of our place. Again, the cameras are a huge help, to make sure there isn't partying happening in the middle of the night, checking, you know, if all of a sudden you get 500 alerts in the middle of the night, you want to wake up and look at what's going on. That's what happened in our case with the flooded rental. They were throwing things down the stairs. If it wasn't for that camera, I would have got there in the morning not knowing what's going on. So water sensors underneath sinks and stuff like that, so at least we can tell if a water pipe burst or if there's some leakage from one of the sinks or something. So all of our place is able to monitor remotely just to make sure it's okay. The only things, again, we don't do are cameras on the inside or record devices on the inside.
You go to prison where that case. Being a voyeur or whatever.
A few stories on that.
Ethically, it's not right, but it's against their policies for Airbnb and VRBO as well.
Yeah. Right.
But what I'm hearing you say, though, but that's a full-time place. Those of us who are just going to do it short-term, I don't think we have to go to that extreme, but I am going to get those exterior cameras.
We
looked at getting them anyway, and now we have more incentive.
Totally agree.
You know, another thing is just get a hold of your neighbors is a good topic. If you're going to rent out your place, just let your neighbors know. So a lot of these neighbors, you know, you get to know, and they're going to watch it out for you and be like, and call you and say, hey, there's 17 cars out here. Two, it's just a courtesy. If you're going to rent it out, some people feel really uncomfortable living next to an Airbnb, and I get both sides of the story. So just make sure you get a hold of your neighbors and say, hey, I'm going to rent this out for the week. If there's any problems, here's my number. Call me right away. And make that open communication so they don't get upset all of a sudden you're renting your place out, you know.
Izzy, one last question for you. You're a police officer for a lot of years. You've dealt with a lot of shady characters or whatever. You guys normally have such a tremendous gut feeling, kind of a radar thing. Did you have that at all with these guys you rented to?
No. In fact, they're, I will say they're big banking investment CEO who's out of Chicago. So
wow.
When you look at, you know, who you're renting to, it's possible anyone can damage your property, whether it's somebody who drives a Maserati or a rusted Honda. You know, you can't judge a book by its cover. And that's where we don't look at people coming and going. We look at the reviews and making ensuring they don't have, you know, their convicted felons running around hopping from place to place. And you're starting to question yourself, why are you renting out five different places in a week, you know? So you can't judge a book by its cover, nor should you in a business. So keep that in mind. It's possible anyone can damage your property or do something with it. But again, it's lucrative and it can be very beneficial towards yourself or the community. Like you said, taxes coming to the area and people spending money in that area is the big one.
Yeah. Visitor and Convention Bureau encourages it. They get their 10%. So, yeah, it's something I'm excited about it. But like I said, I went with, I'm going to lose. The guy's charging me enough commission, but I don't care.
Sure.
You know what I mean? But I just, I'm not a detailed guy.
You'll sleep well.
I go down to the Ostoff. That's where I'm going to be staying because I have a place there. So that's close to where you are.
Yep. Yeah, absolutely.
So that's great.
In our Airbnb too. So.
Izzy Deutsch, I sure do appreciate that. It's great talking to you again.
Yeah.
And you know, your buddy is getting a nice award tonight at the Respect for Law Enforcement banquet. Your buddy Chopper.
Yep.
Nice. Awesome.
Yeah, he's a great guy.
All right.
Thanks for sharing
Izzy,
that.
Izzy, please keep in touch with us. Let us know how this plays out, please.
Yep. Thanks, John.
Thanks, right, buddy. Take care. All right, we come back. Ben and Deanna Malcore joining us. Back after this.
Let me know. Should I stay or should I go? If you say that you are mine, I'll be here till the end of time. So you got to let me know. Should I stay or should I go?
WGBW or Oshkosh Air Support and see the entire show unfold right before your eyes. Now, back to Mino and the Mayor, John Mino and Jim Schmidt.
Oh, yeah.
Hey, welcome back. Special thanks to Izzy Deutsch. Talk about the dangers of Airbnb rental. Tomorrow, though, we'll have Michael on.
Yeah.
From Simple Life Hospitality. Talk about how they make sure they circumvent those things before they happen. But again, we got Ben and Deanna Malcore in here.
Good morning.
And you guys dealing with empty houses at times and different things like that.
Yeah.
I had no idea on your phone and everything you could keep an eye on houses.
Yeah.
Just about everything between the cameras and changing the temperature. And, you know, you can pretty much watch everything.
I mean, not that houses sit for very long anymore.
Right. No.
But I remember a house where, and I was the buyer's agent, and we went in and we looked at it, and they're like, boy, this is really nice, really nice, really nice. And then we went, they said, can we just say it again? And, you know, early next week, this is when houses were not starting, you know, just starting. And we went back, and the pipes had froze.
Oh, no.
And if you've ever seen the force of water, what it could do to a copper pipe, it's like you take a razor blade, just slice it.
Oh, yeah.
And the toilets were all frozen. They all cracked, and it was coming through the ceiling. Yeah.
Like, worst nightmare. Well, I mean, maybe not the worst, but it's pretty bad.
You know what I'm saying, though? I'm with the buyers. And they're like, what happened? It's like,
And
I called the other agent, and I said, hey, it's like, you know, 31 degrees, and your place goes, why? I'm like, why? I don't know. Maybe the furnace went out.
To me, anytime something bursts with the toilet, I'm just running. It's a lost cause.
That force of that ice, what that can do. What I'm saying is if you have one of those sensors or whatever on your phone, because if your house is empty, let's all be honest, we've all gone to vacation in January or February, and in the back of your mind, if you don't have somebody staying there, you got those things in your mind, don't you?
Yeah.
Oh, all the time. And it's peace of mind right away.
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Maybe as we talk about, you know, homes are holding and got great value. But if you're going to do things, we talk about adding doors and windows, which I think is really important. But, you know, to put that system in your home might be a good investment.
Yeah.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. I think smart homes are, you know, becoming, you know, kind of the thing.
Yeah.
You know, having all of that technology that you can watch from anywhere.
Right.
No matter if you're just at work and just, you know, are a little concerned about something that maybe might be happening in the neighborhood. You just want to check your house. Maybe you've had, you know, flooding with rains before, so you want to check to see if there's any water coming in. There's so many things that you can do with those systems.
Yeah, my priority. I have a smart camera, so I can look at my dog.
Yeah, I was gonna go there. That. Yeah, I want one of those things that you can talk to and give it treats.
Yeah, I don't. Yeah.
Todd was talking about that.
Yeah, yeah. That.
Remember you were talking about the audio? We're talking about that where you can give your dog treats over the over your phone.
Yeah, yeah, right. Yeah.
Sure.
Dispense them.
That would just make me happy in the middle of the day. Right.
Don't you get concerned though? I mean, with smart ovens now, they have smart ovens. For as much as we all pocket dial people,
accidentally do that.
Yeah, doesn't that make you a little nervous? Yeah.
However, I just want to tell you, I was down and visiting my daughter and son-in-law, and he bakes. Like I don't bake, I cook, but he bakes and makes these unbelievable breads. And we went to mass, and he just turned on the oven through his phone, and we got back, and it was done.
What happened to me last week? I had an unfortunate, embarrassing incident.
I feel like we can start every show.
Yeah, we could. I know. That's what I'm saying. But
this is literally almost humiliating.
Jim can't even remember.
I know.
I bought a used car. Okay. From somebody I think really took advantage of me in buying this car.
Because John knows so much about cars. But okay.
What, Todd? It was from my wife. She didn't tell me that the lock the remote lock doesn't work.
Oh.
So I accidentally locked it.
Oh, no.
And I could not get in. It's in the parking garage, okay?
Oh.
Yeah. And so the only thing I could get open was the back hatch, like about a foot and a half.
Oh, my God. Did you crawl in?
Yeah.
Okay. And for those
That's
of
not
you,
the bad part.
I think people can guess what happened next. Look at John. Sure. And then we get back to an 18-inch opening.
I got hung up halfway over the back seat. Trying to reach for the latch.
Oh,
and
God.
I'm thinking, okay, do I make one final lunge?
Yeah.
But then if I get stuck, then I'm done. Yeah, then I am stuck.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay?
Yeah.
What level is your car on?
The bottom, very bottom. Very bottom. Sorry.
That would have been funny to see.
Are there cameras down there?
I don't know. I think there might be. I might ask. Yeah. I might ask.
But, yeah. So I finally found a plastic. I had a plastic hanger hanging there. So I gave it another shot. And with the hanger, I was able to open the back door.
Yeah.
But I was completely like hung up.
Yeah. And can you imagine a couple days later, there's an awful odor coming from that. First floor garage. Yeah, we got a couple complaints on that. Let's go look at it. So skeleton.
Oh my God. Is that a Mino in there?
Yeah.
Yeah, that could happen.
I guarantee you if anyone saw you, you made their day.
Yes, I'm sure did. We. But we actually did a people's court thing about if that person that sold me the car. Okay, if they could be liable for anything happened because I was not told that there was defective locks.
So Todd did the music. I was Judge
the
Walker.
The mayor's court.
Judge Walker. Okay. Yeah.
Mayor's court.
What was the finding? What was the ruling?
He sided with the
John goes on and on, 20 minutes, you know, talking about this. And his wife, I asked her like one question. I'm like, I've heard enough. I'll be back after the commercial break.
I'll be back with a rolling right after this.
Oh, my God. Was that Judge Wapner?
Yes.
Judge Wapner.
Absolutely. So I definitely sided with her. So anyway, it was.
He would be pretty good at that, though. I will say this. Todd would be the perfect announcer. Jim would be the perfect judge. Yeah. I'd be Rusty the bailiff. Just stand there. All right. So anyway, we got to talk politically a little bit. I mean, not politically, but... I will say this. I'm surprised it wasn't brought up because they did talk about the housing thing last night a bunch and about some potential things. But there are things that in October, interest rates might really come down.
Mm-hmm.
What are you guys hearing? What are people asking you guys?
You know what? I kind of just heard about it recently as well. I know one of the lenders that we work with, they've invited our office to kind of a lunch and learn because it's a great idea. Yeah, they're excited about it too.
Because there's so many different, things floating in the air.
Yep. So we'll know more after next week for sure once we kind of talk to them.
And there's no guarantee anything's going to happen. But there's just so many rumors floating
around. But it's the month before the election.
Yeah.
I'm sure they'll find a way to finagle somebody to do it.
Yeah.
And last night on the debate, it did come up that, and we talked about this, we touched on it, but... You know, there may be some loans for first-time homebuyers, $25,000. Yeah. And like you and I were saying, Deanna, is that going to raise the price $25,000?
Yeah. The seller is going to say, let's raise it up 25.
Or will it indeed go to the down payment?
Well, you know, there's so many things out there right now anyway. I mean, if people really need... or aren't quite sure whether they can afford that first home or sometimes even their second home, talk to your lender. There are so many great programs out there that people don't know about until you need them.
And they really are. And that, those are the types of things sometimes I think people get discouraged, especially, and you mentioned first-time home buyers, okay? Yeah. But those other people, like, it almost like be me where you've bought a few houses and now you're like, well, I'm never buying a house again.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Until you find out about some of these other things. Because at my age, I don't want to all of a sudden get stuck with whatever, whatever.
Yeah.
But yet, you know, you always have that thought of, I'm going to kick the tires and check out these houses and everything like that. So there are things like that for a person like me could help.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
You know, the politics and, you know, election and everything, you know, that goes along with it, it's all doom and gloom. It's, you know, it's and whatever they're proposing, I mean, it's going to save.
There's people eating dogs and cats. Yeah.
Seemingly.
That is about when I left.
That is when
you tell me. That is going to be the first thing on Saturday Night Live, cold open.
Oh my God. Yeah.
The chef's going to come out. And he's gonna
I know. Oh my goodness gracious. So there's so many great programs out there already. There really is. There's no doom and gloom to this industry right now. So you just need to talk to your lender.
Yeah. But you know, another thing too with first-time home buyers, I think they're a little bit of a, I mean, there's so much information, like you said, out there versus my era coming out of college or whatever, mm-hmm. and interest rates were 14%.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And we didn't have a pot to pee in and whatever, but we wanted a house because even back then, down in a college town, your rent is high.
Crazy.
Yeah.
And we didn't have a clue. Yeah. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And nowadays, I think these young people are so much better educated and more aware, and they take it upon themselves. I mean, let's be honest. In our era, it's pretty much whatever your dad said, even after you were married or whatever. It's like, what did your dad say?
Yeah, right.
Well, he said we should. Exactly. Yeah. And it's a different era.
It is, and thank God it is, because I think I told you my daughter and her husband, the newly married, bought a house, which was significantly more than the house I live in now, but it was in Nashville and it was downtown. And she called, Dad, you know, should we do this? I'm like, honey, this is where I get off. You talk
exactly. That's exactly what I mean.
I was glad she called. I felt honored, but I'm like, you talk to Robbie about that because you don't want to get involved in case it doesn't go good. You know, you're up at $500,000. That's a lot of money for, you know, people starting out. But John's right. I mean, totally, Dad, should I do this? Yeah. No, don't do that. Yeah.
Exactly.
You know what I mean? It was
absolutely.
But now there's people like you that are more helpful. Yeah. I mean,
well,
really.
You know, and you're finding too, we've got two really, very distinct groups of younger individuals, first time home buyers. I think we've got kind of an older group. You know, we all bought really young. We got married a little bit younger. We bought our house. It's what you were supposed to do.
Just the way it went. Exactly.
Yeah, that's what you did. We're now, I think that age group has moved up a little bit. They're a little bit older, they've saved, they've landed their great job, you know, they feel a little bit more secure before they're going to jump into buying a house. And then we've got this really young group that's starting to see the value of buying real estate, and they're becoming investors really young. And so they're buying something that they're going to live in for a couple of years, they'll buy something else. So they're starting to build their portfolio really young, which is amazing to me. I did not have that.
Well, we did, like we're saying, in my age or whatever, even not that long ago, the only thing you really knew about real estate was Sunday in the paper. They'd have the classifieds, and you'd read a little description, and you didn't really know any agents. There was, you know, you'd just make a phone call. And
I want to ask you guys about that, because there still are open houses. You know, I see those. I like houses. I like to look at them, but I can't do that on my own anymore. I need to call you and become a buyer's agent for the day, for the week, for the month.
Nope, you can go see any open house you want on your own. Absolutely. You can't.
I thought you needed a.
Only if we're showing you
only
on
if
a,
you
like
make
a
an
private
appointment
show.
With
yep.
you, right?
Yep.
I see.
Yep.
Yeah. It's considered a public invite, an open house. So it's not, there's no degree of agency.
I see. But
there,
if I see a sign, I want to go see the house, then I need to go in with a buyer's agent.
Precisely.
I got it.
Yeah.
And they can call you. You'll take the call.
Yep.
Okay.
So an open house, we're really there on behalf of the seller. We're not there on your behalf. It's an open event. Anyone can come, whether you're working with an agent, they just can't make it, or whether you haven't even, this may be your first house that you're looking at. It doesn't matter. You can come. But if you want to continue on with that agent that's there, then you need to sign an agreement.
Okay. With anyone, with you or with
anyone? Right. It doesn't matter who you're working with. You have to have something in place even just to see a house.
And if you're listing the house and you're the seller's agent, can you also be the buyer's agent?
Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
That's the.
Yep.
That's
I know the answer. I passed the test. I was just going to ask it for. I was asking
it
for.
It hasn't changed.
Okay. All right. Good.
It was a rhetorical question,
right?
Yeah.
But you know, another thing though, too, when we're talking about these young people, and you said they're getting investing in real estate, that's as good of a thing to get involved with it.
Absolutely.
No matter if you have your highs or lows, I don't know many people that said, son of a gun, I'm sorry you invested in that property 20 years ago.
And if you're paying, you know, whatever, it's $1,800 for rent, and you can buy a house and get $2,000, it's forced savings is what it is.
Yeah.
You're building equity, that's what we call it.
Absolutely.
But it's forced savings, and we're just not great savers in America.
No, so, we're not. I think we've talked about that almost every show.
I mean, but houses...
it's true.
But houses are for, you know, all of a sudden it's like, wait a minute, I got $10,000 in this house.
Yeah. But we've helped so many people who, young buyers who have purchased like a duplex. So they live on one side, owner-occupied, and they rent out the other, and the renter pays for their mortgage, which is fantastic.
That's a
so
sweet
smart.
Deal.
We had a young couple, and it was just a couple years ago that we helped them buy that duplex, that multifamily.
And now they're on their next one.
And they're already on to their next one. So just really, really smart.
Yeah.
And really smart.
Our previous guest believed in him and his his wife or his partner bought a intentionally for Airbnb.
Yeah.
In Sheboygan Falls, which is it's not that big of a city. I mean, we're much bigger than I think there's a lot more going on here. And I still think that could be, he said that can be very lucrative.
Oh, absolutely.
He made a couple mistakes. We just talked to you about the bad tenant, but
he was a cop. He was a cop in Green Bay who dealt with some of the scummiest, whatever. And every cop I know pretty much is that way. It's like, he's a jerk. He's a guy. Stay away. You know what I mean? But he said these were big time financial Chicago bankers driving this big, beautiful, you know what I mean? It's like, you just don't know sometimes.
I know. It's so
haven't you had that though in real estate where it's like somebody, it's like at first, oh, this is so great. Oh, thank you so much. And then something, the slightest thing goes wrong and you see a different side of them.
Right away.
Snap.
But I think we were talking about, you know, living on one side of a duplex and having the person on the other side pay the mortgage. And that's what Airbnb can do if you manage it right.
Yeah,
they can actually pay the mortgage, but you've got to have a community that has events, that has a draw. And I think we have that here.
So. Oh, absolutely. For sure.
We're with Ben and Deanna Malcore, Bay Area Realty, right downtown here in Gray Bay on Walnut and Broadway. Back with more with them right after this.
Not at all.
Hey, welcome back. Minor and the Mayor here on a Wednesday morning. Ben and Deanna Malcore, Bay Area Realty. What else is going on?
Yeah. Let's talk a little bit about what to do before fall hits.
Fall's coming.
Sounds good.
Your house. Yeah, right?
Like,
yeah.
A week from Sunday, huh?
Yeah, a week
Does
from
Sunday. Does it really?
Yeah.
It's crazy.
It feels like fall this morning.
Yeah.
Can I just say, so I don't mean to take away your time, but you mentioned St. Willibrod. I walked past that. That really needs some upkeep. You've seen the paint. You need to paint the doors and the frames. It's all peeling and chipping.
Sure.
You can get a bunch of guys there. I'll go help volunteer. It's the
Norbertines on that. So
yeah,
those guys got plenty.
Get a hold of the Norbertines for me.
Yeah. Give Father Andy a call.
Yes.
Come on.
Is Father Jim a Norbertine? Okay, Father Jim,
first
give me a call.
If you go see Pastor Andy over there, the first thing you say, John, I haven't seen you here in a while.
I'm in the choir.
I'm up in the loft.
Yes. Your eyes aren't what they used to be.
Bad eyes. Bad eyes.
So there. Yeah, I'm here. Wow. Okay. Hey,
I've never seen a comment just stop the conversation so quickly.
Like that one did.
All right.
Wow.
But it is fall. What should we be doing? I mean, really, Ben, tell us what we should do.
You know, check your gutters. Obviously the leaves are going to start falling very, very soon.
Can I just say something?
Yeah.
Have somebody check your gutters. I've done it. It's the worst job that there is with that slop that gets in there.
Yeah.
You don't know what to do with it. It's dangerous at times reaching for places. Yeah. Go ahead.
Yeah.
I just love the ER, but they talk about, you know, what kind of, but Saturday, it's people like you, John.
After your car story, you should not check your gutter.
That's a really good point.
There's people that do that.
Yes. Yeah, but you know those leaves, they get caught up there. Inevitably, the water clogs up.
Mm-hmm.
You get your first freeze. You get an ice dam in there, which will ruin your roof. You'll start to see leaks coming into your house.
And we have some kind of we always call them choke cherries. Cherries that you can't really eat. They're just kind of...
Oh,
and
sure.
They get mixed up with that purple and whatever. And it is... the worst job. Yeah. So hire people that do that.
Hire somebody to do it.
You know, and those guys, people, you know, tease me a little bit because I have people do stuff at my house, but it's their job and they're good at it. This guy comes over with a cherry picker. I mean, right? I'm not going to. I go right through the house.
Especially a five-story house like you have.
But anyway, there are people who can do that. I'm just saying that people who are maybe, you know, Johnny and I, you can hire someone to do that. And they enjoy doing it. They make a couple bucks.
It's what they do.
It's what they,
it's what they do.
They got the equipment.
I think DIY is very overrated.
Oh,
DIY is very overrated.
Those TV shows have caused too many problems, haven't they?
I saw it on YouTube, Doc.
I know.
Yeah. Just because you can doesn't mean you should.
On a lot of stuff. All right. So I agree with you. We got to clean that out.
Yeah. I mean, another thing is cracks in your driveway, sealing them. It's very overlooked around here. You know, the reality is that, you know, you get water. We get a lot of rain. Which ultimately leads to snow come wintertime. You get some moisture in there. That moisture freezes in those cracks and ends up breaking up your concrete even more. So
it's like we're talking about the pipes that I told you. Water is the most forceful thing.
It is. You know, and if you have a few cracks when you go to sell, if your buyer wants some of that kind of fixed, you know, if it's not too bad, you can have your driveway mud jacked and kind of raised, which is a lot less expensive than having your driveway pulled out and redone.
Do you guys walk the bridge? This one?
We do.
What's that yellow stuff they got between the cracks? A yellowish green?
I have no idea.
Okay, have you noticed that? Seems like they put that in all the cracks. I was wondering if homeowners can use that.
Oh.
Yeah. What does it taste like, John?
Kind of like gum you would find on the side.
Like a little kid.
What is it? All right, number three.
Number three, check for any drafts in your windows.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
You know, they make that, especially in the older homes, you know, things just aren't as tight as they are. Right. And some of the new construction.
Save you a lot of money.
Sensors to do that.
And the old thing was they'd put a candle by it, and you'd be shocked at how much that flame is, you know, bursting in.
Yeah.
I remember my mom's old house because we would do the old plastic on the inside.
Oh, sure. Oh,
yeah. Did you ever else ever grow up with that?
I didn't, but is that where you do the hair dryer?
Yeah, the hair dryer.
Get the wrinkles out of the plastic.
Absolutely. Yeah.
As neighbors, we love that.
If we were on camera, I'd give you a little something right here. Wow.
Yeah.
Next one, Ben.
Next. Drain your outdoor faucets again.
Oh, yeah. Absolutely.
Power of water.
That is a YouTube thing, though. That is not... To have somebody, a plumber, come over and do that, it's like, okay, wait a minute, that's not, I do that, which, and I know how to do nothing. That is the one thing takes two of us to do it. But that, and that's really good advice because we had a pipe burst. Thank God it was in the garage, but it's expensive. They come back and
I don't think there's anything dangerous in that one.
No, well, you got to know where your shutoff valve is inside.
Yep. For sure.
That's the key for sure.
Yep.
And then they do, at like a Menards or wherever, they do make insulating kits, don't they, to put around the outside faucet?
They put a nice cap on. Yeah. Nice styrofoam cap.
Yeah.
Yeah. And as we get older.
Or like we do in the UP, people do in the UP, they just buy the regular insulation from inside your house that they had left over for 38 years.
Yeah.
And it's upstairs the garage. And they grab that and they duct tape it and they put it together.
Duct tape it on.
Again. Yes. As neighbors, we love that.
Someday, if I win the lottery, I'm going to move next to you.
Oh, my God.
I swear to God.
And his front door is going to be that color.
Yes. God. Right there. I'm going to be changing the oil in my driveway. I'm going to have it up on blocks for a while. Awesome.
Yes.
Awesome.
Yep. Okay. Wedged in the trunk.
Absolutely.
Wedged in the trunk.
Yep.
Yeah.
All right. Give us another one, Ben. These are good. I like these.
Yeah. Changing your filters, of course, on your HVAC system. You know, as dust starts to accumulate, inevitably that you got to have good airflow or you're going to have some huge problems.
Yeah. And right along with that, too, probably changing the batteries. I mean, not that it's a fall thing, but change the batteries in your fire alarm and carbon monoxide and all that.
Because there's nothing worse than that goes off in the middle of the night.
Especially
with
a dog.
That happened to me at a hotel this summer. Remember I told you that, Jeff?
Yeah.
And the guy came in, he didn't do it right. It kept going off again.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's like,
our dog is very afraid. If it starts beeping, it sets him off.
Really?
Yeah. We've got to take him outside. He's so nervous.
No kidding. Whoa.
Yeah.
What does Milton do? Go deeper under the bed? deeper under the covers?
That. He hasn't done that. So.
Take care of it, Dad. Those are all really great things, though.
And yeah. We really great house. And it, those are all things that, you know, bring more value to your house, right?
They
especially
do.
You talk about that air filter thing, the gutters. I mean, those are things like, come on, it's you got a couple good months to do it. It's going to be super nice out these next few weeks. And and then that brings your more value to your house. And then if you want to sell it, you call you guys. And,
you're showing the buyers that you're maintaining your house really well. And that speaks volumes.
Can tell.
Yeah, absolutely they can. Yeah.
Give yourselves a plug.
Well, you know, we have an open house tomorrow over by Red Smith School right on Spyglass
Hill. Oh, that one you were talking about last week.
2:30 to 4, I think it is. So stop in and see us.
Nice.
Give us the address again.
Oh my gosh, 3548.
Spyglass Hill?
I believe, 3548 Spyglass Hill Drive.
Well, you'll have this sign there. Yeah. Fun.
And if anybody's looking to buy, give you guys a call.
Absolutely.
They'll explain the whole, you guys will explain the whole buyer's agent thing.
Of course we will.
Awesome.
317 West Walnut.
Ben and Deanna Malcore, Bay Area Realty. They will be the greatest people you'll ever talk to when it comes to real estate. Thank you guys for being here.
Oh, thanks for having us.
That's awesome.
Thanks so much.
Back at this. Brothers got tonight to keep you coming around.